next on Unsolved Mysteries. An unsigned confession and a bizarre psychic vision. Both suggest that a mysterious death may have been murder. Days after the death of White House advisor Vince Foster, a suicide note was found in his briefcase. But some experts believe it's a clever forgery. They call themselves walk-ins. Could their bodies really have been invaded by another person's soul? And in Phoenix, Arizona, a businessman vanishes and his car is found burning 400 miles away. What went wrong?
Join us for five cases with twists and turns that you can hardly believe. I'm Dennis Farina, and you're watching Unsolved Mysteries. It's Sunday morning in Dunedin, Florida, an hour and a half before Robert Derschel and his wife Ginny plan to head off to church.
I heard a sound, a loud sound, but I assumed it was the slamming of the back door.
A few minutes later, Ginny goes to the bedroom to dress. She finds her husband dead, shot through the chest.
I called the police, and it seemed like they arrived immediately.
What time did you get here?
8:15.
Investigators find no evidence of a break-in, no sign of a struggle. A shotgun lies on the bed nearby.
So here, the left shoe is off. I think what he did is he sat on the edge of the bed, put the shotgun up to his chest, pulled the trigger with his big toe.
Ginny tells the police that her husband was applying medicine to a foot ailment before putting on his Sunday shoes. But within 15 minutes, the police conclude that Robert's death was a suicide. And with that, the case is closed.
16 years later, Robert Derschel's son received a mysterious letter. It was short, just 33 words, but the disturbing message put the theory of suicide in question.
When Guy Derschel got the letter, he noticed that it was postmarked March 13th, exactly 16 years to the day after his father's death.
I read it once, and I read it the second time, and I was just totally flooded with emotion. It was as if I'd been kicked right in the chest.
The letter was brief and direct. It said, "I have AIDS. I am dying. I must make peace with the Lord. I killed your daddy 16 years ago. He found me in his bedroom. I had no choice. Please, pray for me." The unsigned letter prompted the Derschel family to obtain a copy of the original police report on Robert's death. The Derschels had never seen it before, and they went over it word by word.
It was just so full of untruths, guesswork, interviews of people that hadn't seen my father in more than 2 years. Close friends weren't spoken to.
In the report, investigators had concluded that Robert committed suicide because of an unsuccessful surgery years earlier.
The one interview that they probably weigh most heavily is from a nurse who hadn't seen him in 2 years, who gives a report about his health that is so far from the truth, it's ridiculous. She portrays him as a bedridden vegetable, where he was a happy, fairly healthy man, had social life, he still traveled, and still was a productive salesman.
It was strictly investigated as a suicide. I don't think there were any fingerprints taken of the gun or any place in the house. And that was the biggest mistake they made, not investigating.
In law enforcement,
We have to deal with what the evidence tells us. There seemed to be no sign of struggle, no forcible entry, no disarray of any description in the bedroom where this encounter allegedly occurred, which again was one of the, gives us more belief that this was a suicide.
For Robert's wife, Jenny, and their children, the case was far from over. While traveling by train from Florida to California, Jenny's sister, Fran, met a psychic who was able to describe Robert's death in eerie detail.
Fran?
Well, yes?
Was your husband a doctor?
The young woman was a total stranger, but she seemed familiar with Fran and the Dershowls.
Well, then your husband's name was Earl.
Yes, that's right.
Well, they're here. With Bob, your sister's husband, and he was murdered. I think it's best that I write this down so that you can keep it with you and give it to your sister, Jenny.
My first reaction to psychic was, I mean, I didn't believe in psychics. I'm sorry. And yet, the more I heard, I had to say I believe in this.
I see a narrow door opening with a gun case showing. And your sister's husband is going to another cabinet to look for foot treatment for athlete's foot. He looks up and he sees a stranger in the adjoining room. The robber fights with Bob.
The things that were written by the young lady on the Amtrak train were startling in that some of this information wasn't anywhere to be found. It was just too real. It was as if this person was in the room.
She's made no effort to gain from it. There's been no approach to us, which you would expect if there was a hoax. And I honestly believe it was a situation that took place that I can't explain in the reality of this world. It's kind of spooky.
Bob Dershowl died at 54, well before his time. To this day, his family would like to know why.
In my own mind, my father is a victim of murder. And I would like to be able to tell my children without a question that this is what happened.
There may be somebody out there who was talked to by the killer, revealed something in prison to an attorney, to a parent, to a friend. That's one of my hopes, is that somebody out there can fit the last piece of the puzzle into place.
Robert Dershowl's wife passed away without ever resolving the mystery of her husband's death. But Robert's children hope the truth will someday be revealed. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, handwriting experts make a stunning claim about the suicide note found in Vince Foster's briefcase. The White House, Washington, D.C.
I have just met with the White House staff to basically talk with them a little bit about the death of my friend of 42 years, Vince Foster.
Early in the Clinton presidency, his deputy counsel, Vincent W. Foster, died unexpectedly. Foster was 48. His body was found in a park across the Potomac River from Washington. Foster had been shot once in the head. The wound was apparently self-inflicted. At the time of his death, Foster had been implicated in the Whitewater scandal. The United States Park Police and the FBI concluded that Foster had taken his own life. But journalists raised serious doubts about that theory.
Vince Foster was the highest federal official to die under suspicious circumstances since the death of President Kennedy. I don't push a non-suicide theory. I have never said Vince Foster was murdered. I have said that police are trained to treat every suicide, no matter how apparently, as a homicide, as a murder first, until the facts prove otherwise. What is clear in this case is that police procedure was never followed.
One of the key clues in this case is a note, allegedly written by Vince Foster. The message was unsigned. This is a copy of the reconstructed note, which, when found, had been ripped into 28 pieces. It read, in part,
I made mistakes from ignorance, inexperience, and overwork. I did not knowingly violate any law or standard of conduct. No one in the White House, to my knowledge, violated any law or standard of conduct. I was not meant for the job or the spotlight of public life in Washington. Here, ruining people is considered sport.
The shredded note was found in Foster's briefcase 4 days after his death. Curiously, White House counsel Bernard Nussbaum had searched the briefcase earlier, but did not find the note. This put the document's authenticity in question. More than 2 years after Foster died, a team of well-known handwriting experts held a press conference in Washington. Each of these experts examined a photocopy of the alleged suicide note and concluded that it was a forgery.
Was there any substance to the claim that the suicide note was forged? We invited these same handwriting experts to meet with us in Boston to explain their conclusions.
The experts compared the suicide note to 12 other samples of Foster's handwriting. Ronald Rice, a handwriting examiner who has worked for the state of Massachusetts, is convinced that the note was forged.
If we compare the formation of the cursive capital I here on the question document to the formation of the capital I here on the known document authored by Mr. Foster, we can plainly see it is not the same. It's an entirely different letter formation.
Rice went on to describe other discrepancies. For example, in the suicide note, the letter O is open. In the known samples, it's closed. In addition, Rice claims that the letter B in the note was made with at least 4 strokes of the pen. He says that in the known sample, the letter was written with 1 continuous stroke.
Plainly see the weakness in the
discrepancy. Rice discovered numerous other discrepancies and believes the suicide note was not written by Foster.
My study and examination concluded that this was a document that was very skeptical, and it was my opinion that it was a forgery.
Handwriting experts say that Foster's writing was typified by U-shaped strokes known as swags. Reginald Ault of Oxford University in England believes the forger had a difficult time imitating Foster's graceful style.
Foster writes Clinton's. The IN is an elegant double swag. When the forger writes Clinton's, we find the strokes are not easy and elegant and not really on form at all.
There were an inordinate amount of hesitation dots found in the document.
Hesitation dots are small blobs of ink left where the pen starts or stops. Anthony Iantosca explains that when a document has many dots, it's a tip-off that the penmanship was being copied.
If you take a look at the capital letter N, you'll see 4 distinct hesitation dots starting at the top where the pen comes in contact with the paper, it stops, he comes down, and it stops at the bottom. He comes back up and retraces. He comes back down again, you see a 3rd hesitation dot. He stops, he comes back up, and you'll see a heavy concentration of ink right here for the 4th hesitation dot.
Retired homicide investigator Vincent Scalisi is a certified document examiner. He points to the fact that the words beginning with the letters TH are much more crudely written in the suicide note than in the known samples. Some suggest the differences can be explained by stress. The stress of a man about to kill himself. But these experts disagree.
Your handwriting would not change because you were under that type of stress. It might get a little sloppier, it might get a little less clear, but your style of writing normally would not change.
Our four experts all concluded that the note was forged, but at least one other expert says it's authentic.
There's nothing in the question document that would support any finding of forgery. And the things that are brought forth, the apparent fragmentation in those things, are explained by the fact that we have a deteriorated copy and the fact that the man was under some emotional stress at the time.
Marcel Matley is convinced that the other experts are wrong, and he demonstrates why. On the left side is writing from the suicide note. On the right side are other writing samples of Foster's. They are labeled K1 through K11.
We have three thus from the suicide note, three from the first known sample. You cannot tell the difference in these words. The only thing that might be a difference is here where it's deteriorated. This is from the photocopy that's been copied too often. The loop is gone and the stem is gone. The second word, two, we have four of them in the question document, one of which is where the tear is, so we can ignore it. But you notice these three twos have differences among them. We go to K9 and K10, we get three more words, T-O. We have the same difference. From comparing these words, the conclusion is the same person wrote both writings.
Did Vince Foster write the suicide note? Or, as Clinton critics contend, is the note part of an elaborate cover-up? There have been three official investigations into Foster's death. The most comprehensive took 3 years and was conducted by Kenneth Starr. All three concluded that his death was a suicide. Yet, the doubt still persists. And if the note is in fact a forgery, who wrote it and why? These lingering questions may never be laid to rest. Next, meet two people who claim that their bodies have been taken over by someone else's soul. They call themselves walk-ins.
Is it possible that a person's body can be invaded by someone else's soul? Well, it sounds improbable, but there are thousands of people who say it has happened to them. They call themselves walk-ins.
I began to feel that I had to change my name. And this happens very often to walk-ins. And I didn't know why.
I felt like a stranger in a strange land. I didn't fit here. I didn't understand this world. I didn't understand how it worked.
Let's do an IV.
The doctor patted me and he said, "Young lady, you gave us quite a scare." And I said, "Oh, I'm not who you think I am."
Believers say it's not possession. It's an even trade, one soul for another. And they say that it could happen to any one of us. A hospital in Clearwater, Florida, is where Carol Parrish first experienced being a walk-in.
All right, here we go.
While giving birth to her sixth child, doctors gave Carol a shot of sodium pentothal to ease her pain.
Nurse, 2 cc's of sodium pentothal.
But Carol had an allergic reaction to the drug, and her lungs collapsed.
All right, we've got an anaphylactic shock, nurse. Let's get some oxygen going.
Carol was on the edge of death.
Suddenly, I wasn't there. It was just like I had been totally engaged in that struggle, and the next thing, it's cool, and I'm floating, and I look down, and you hardly know that that's you.
All right, we've got
Carol watched while her baby was being born. Then she says her soul entered a tunnel of light where she felt that she was not alone. She described it as a near-death experience.
And I stood there, and in that light, it was like a whole flow of information just came into my mind, and this love and this wisdom just permeated wave after wave of understanding, wisdom, richness. This flowed into me.
Defying all expectations, Carol survived. But she says that when she woke up, her body had been taken over by a different soul.
You're lucky to be alive.
I saw young Carol move off into the care of some other beings.
I'm not who you think that I am.
It's okay.
As I look at each person, their eyes, just the veil comes over their eyes. And I turned my head toward the wall, and big tears started coming in my eyes and down my cheeks. And I thought, how will I ever get anybody to believe me? Who's going to listen?
From then on, everything about Carol's life changed. She began having out-of-body experiences.
One day I was nursing the baby, and I found myself standing in the door looking at myself, and immediately thought, oh, that's happening to me again. When I thought that, I popped back together, and it passed. And I tried to talk about that to my family.
Her husband thought she had gone crazy.
Where's your medicine?
And her doctor tried to put her on Valium.
I'm not taking it anymore.
Why not?
It's not good for the baby.
Carol, the doctor said you've got to take that medicine.
The new Carol made big changes in her life.
Bill, I am not taking the medicine anymore.
She went back to school to study bookkeeping and became a manager at a local bank. Her new identity seemed to threaten her husband, who eventually left her.
The years after the experience were very lonely. I was lonely for other people that valued the things that were so meaningful to me.
7 years later, Carol began to study religion and became a minister. Her faith gave her a new perspective on being a walk-in.
I believe young Carol went, as all souls do, into tender hands to care for her and help her reorient herself to the world of spirit. The idea that life is ongoing, and if you are, you always will be. That's the piece that I think is so important. Partly it's important because we would live life more courageously if we really believed that.
An exchange of souls. Is this really possible? A woman named Sherry claims that it happened to her too. She was a high school principal, and while visiting a friend in Wyoming, Sherry began to feel disoriented. She asked her friend, a metaphysical healer, to lay hands on her. Suddenly, the room began to change.
There was a globe of golden pulsating energy. The core of the energy just punched right into the base of my spine. I raised up on my knees and sat immersed in this colorful light and found myself wanting to just flow with it and dance with it with my hands and my arms.
After the experience, Sherry's life changed dramatically. She claimed her old soul was exchanged for a new one. She even gave herself a new name.
I'm Joelle.
But her new identity came with some problems. Everyday tasks became nearly impossible.
There was a hypersensitivity to energy fields around people, energy fields around things. So to go into a supermarket, see the energy fields, hear all the thoughts, It was so difficult to stay focused on what my task was. I tried to narrow my task down to 5 to 10 items so I could get through that express line as quick as possible.
Over time, Joelle managed to accept her new identity. And so did her husband and daughter.
It's as though there are two chapters in our lives as a family. There's the before and there's the after. And in many ways, our life as a family started after my mother experienced the walk-in. A lot of the healing that wasn't able to take place before did after. We're so much stronger as a family unit.
Joelle is now dedicated to educating others about the walk-in experience.
I travel the country, I travel the world, speaking to different groups of people, doing private counseling sessions with people.
However, Joelle says that she still retains some traits from before the change, when she was still Sherry.
One of the beautiful memories that came from Sherry was her ability to teach, was her ability to speak to people. I've taken that aspect and I've just taken it to the next phase.
People who claim a new soul resides inside them say that the new spirit has changed them for the better. When it comes to walk-ins, perhaps that's all that matters. Coming up, the secret life of an Arizona businessman erupts in violence and murder. Phoenix, Arizona. 57-year-old Angelo Desideri was a devout Catholic who had once studied for the priesthood.
Angelo was a very ordered, neat individual. Very, very meticulous, a neat individual. A perfectionist. In its true sense of the word, a perfectionist.
Angelo had several close friends, but never married. With hard work, he built a small business empire that included a shopping center and an import store. On Monday morning, a neighboring shop owner noticed that Angelo's store was not open. One of Angelo's friends drove to his house to see if anything was wrong.
After seeing certain things that disturbed me, like an alarm that was not on and other things of that nature, I went next door and made the decision to phone 911 and bring out a police officer so we could enter the house.
Inside, Angelo was nowhere to be found. It looked like he had been interrupted while preparing lunch. Piles of bills were laid out on the kitchen table, ready to be paid. In the living room were two new pairs of pants with a receipt that showed that Angelo had bought them the day before.
When my brother disappeared on that Sunday afternoon, he left the house with absolutely nothing. He didn't take a toothbrush, a pair of slippers, nothing. The only thing that we discovered that was missing was his attaché case, some jewelry, and money was missing from the home.
In the garage, investigators found Angelo's car cover crumpled on the floor. That was unusual and not a good sign. Angelo was compulsively neat and always folded the cover after removing it. A neighbor told police that he had seen Angelo's Cadillac speed away on the Sunday he disappeared.
It was very difficult to see. Of course, I couldn't see any facial characteristics, and it wasn't like Angelo to pull out without acknowledging me. He'd returned from out of town just a few days before. I'd given him his mail, and we spoke briefly Friday night, which was prior to, this was on a Sunday. And it just, all kinds of questions. You wonder why.
Only 30 hours after Angelo vanished, a 1985 Cadillac was found on fire in the San Diego parking lot 400 miles from Phoenix. An accelerant had been used to set the blaze. The car belonged to Angelo Desideri. Inside, there were no personal belongings and no signs of forced entry.
The ignition was untampered with. There were no signs or indications of any hot wiring of any type. We looked into the trunk and found absolutely nothing in that trunk that would have been there other than the jack. No carpet, no padding, no spare tire. Basically, this tells us that there could have been something in the vehicle that was transported in the vehicle, and when it was taken out, they took the carpet and the padding and wrapped it all in one unit and took everything out of the vehicle, including the spare tire.
Phoenix police retraced the route to San Diego, stopping at gas stations and car washes along the way. Nobody matching Angelo's description had been seen, and none of his credit cards had been used. Authorities did find two witnesses who saw the car just minutes before it was torched. Both described a man who looked like Angelo in front of the Cadillac. However, neither was positive that it was actually him. The investigation hit a dead end.
We can narrow that down to about 5 minutes prior to the fire. The results of our case rest on who that person was. It could possibly close our case if it was Angelo standing by that car.
I cannot conceive that he would burn the car. It just seems incredible that this is possible of my brother. I can't comprehend something like this.
All the pieces, they just don't fit. We have a gentleman who would go out of his way for people, someone who was devoted to his family. And yet, we have this whole case. There's another life, or there's another dimension to Angelo that we've never been able to find. And I think that if I could ever find that piece, I'd find Angelo.
Update. 9 months after Angelo disappeared, Phoenix police charged a local man, Joe Callow, with conspiracy to commit armed robbery on Angelo. It turned out that Callow was a business associate of Angelo's and had detailed information about his disappearance.
Joe Callow told us that all the information he had was told to him by James Majors.
James Majors had worked with Callow in construction. At the time of Callow's arrest, Majors was in a California jail facing several counts of murder.
During the interview of Joe Callow, he stated that Majors went to the house, got into the house by ringing the doorbell and asking for a glass of water, then took Angelo at gunpoint and robbed the house. He was taken out of the house at that time by Majors and driven out into the desert.
Callow claims that between Phoenix and San Diego, Majors murdered Angelo. He then placed the body in the trunk of the Cadillac and continued on towards San Diego.
The following morning, Majors goes to a hardware store where he purchased a pick and a shovel.
Have a nice day.
Majors told Callow that he then drove down a desert back road and buried Angelo near a large tree.
According to Callow, Majors did a real unique thing. As he's leaving the gravesite, he stopped and gave the shovel and the pick to the poor people that lived in that shack. And then he exited onto the highway and drove into California.
Callow also told investigators that Majors had a storage locker. When the police searched it, they recovered property that belonged to Angelo. 6 weeks later, two campers discovered the body of Angelo Desideri buried beneath a tree in Kitchen Creek, California. The question is, why was he murdered? It turns out that there was another side to Angelo Desideri. He and Callow belonged to the same organized crime family. When Angelo wanted out, Callow was ordered to have him killed. James Majors was the hitman. Callow was also implicated in several other murders. And in order to avoid the death penalty, he pleaded guilty and was sentenced to 11 consecutive life sentences. James Majors was not tried for killing Angelo Desideri. He had already been sentenced to death for three other murders. Next, after 20 years, a young man is reunited with his lost big brother, who was his inspiration in life. And coming up, is the power of aphrodisiacs a myth or reality? Elkhart, Indiana. It's 1971. Big Brothers of America has just opened a new chapter here. Their first little brother is 7-year-old Jeff Fisher. Jeff's big brother is John Novotny, a local salesman and the father of a 2-year-old daughter.
John gave me the companionship that I really needed at that time. Just the fact that this was, you know, an older guy that I could hang around with and not, you know, not have him tell me to go away and, you know, come back later and stuff. Some, you know, a guy that wanted to spend some time with me, you know, made me feel really good.
Yeah. Get this tied up and then we're just about ready.
After Jeff and John started seeing each other, I noticed that Jeff had a lot more confidence in himself. And he was very proud of the fact that he had a big brother. And he would tell the other kids, well, John and I are going to go do this, or my big brother and I are going to go do this. He was very proud of the fact that he had a man in his life.
It's ready to light.
A year and a half later, John and his family moved away. Jeff never saw John again, but he never forgot the friendship and the adventures that changed his life.
He just introduced me to a world that I had never seen before, and if I finally see him again, I just want to thank him. He made a lasting impression. It's been 20 years, and he's still a really vivid part of my memory.
Update. On the night of our broadcast, several calls from our viewers connected Jeff and John. 9 days later, they were reunited in Tacoma, Washington.
There they are. There they are. Hi, guys.
Hi. Good. Nice to meet you. I can't believe
we Hey, you look just like your picture, man.
How you doing?
Great, great.
It's unbelievable. I was absolutely stunned. I had absolutely no idea that Jeff was looking for me. And then as the show aired, people from Elkhart and from Michigan started calling me on the phone, telling me that I was on television and that Jeff Fisher was looking for me. And we must have got 35 calls that night and at least that many the next night.
You know, I've been wanting to say thanks to this guy for 18 years and, you know, whatever it took to come out and say that, you know, I was willing to do.
Admit it, unless you're some kind of a rock star, you've probably wished for a magic potion that can make you seem like a tantalizing love machine that cannot be resisted. Well, join the crowd, folks. For the last few thousand years, men and women have searched the world over for the perfect aphrodisiac. But are there actually recipes for romance that do deliver the goods? Persistent scientific study has produced a surprising answer.
One of the traditions in Europe was that newlywed couples would drink a wine made of honey every night, and this would be a way for them to help increase their energy during the first month of their marriage, and that's where the word honeymoon came about. And, of course, we know honey is very, very high in B vitamins and amino acids and is a very, very highly nutritious product. Plus, it gives the body energy, which is required also for healthy sex.
Oysters have always had the reputation as the food for lovers. For some, just a peek at this succulent mollusk can provoke thoughts of sex. Lab tests indicate that the oyster's fame is honestly earned.
Zinc is a mineral that's required for the production of testosterone, and testosterone is the most important hormone for sexual response in both men and women. And oysters have more zinc than almost any other food.
Though Dr. Watson has spent several years studying aphrodisiacs, many patients who come to her don't realize that they're just lovesick.
So, Charlie, are you having trouble sleeping?
Yeah.
Charlie was there because his 18-hour workdays had ground him down beyond exhaustion.
I get up and walk around. I can't get back to sleep. She starts to steer her questions to, what are my activities like? Am I energetic? Do I exercise? You know, how's my love life? That was kind of an odd switch because most doctors don't take you down that path.
And how are these problems affecting you sexually?
Well, it's taken its toll on my relationship to the point where it's non-existent.
Dr. Watson prescribed a slower pace for Charlie, plus some herbs and vitamins. She also suggested he bring his girlfriend a box of chocolates for dessert. But these were chocolates that Dr. Watson had spiced with South American herbs, known for giving the libido a lift.
That was so delicious.
Charlie invited his girlfriend for dinner. He put on special music and remembered his plans for dessert, and he hoped for the best.
We're not done yet. I have a little dessert for us.
Oh, chocolate hearts.
Not just ordinary chocolate hearts, though. These are aphrodisiacs.
Where did you get them?
About half an hour later, I'm sitting there. She's playing with my hair. And I'm sitting there going, oh, it's working.
I'm so glad you didn't have to work late tonight.
She said, oh, I just feel normal. Well, I can tell you, she wasn't normal. She was better than normal. Cuddly, huggy, you know, paying attention to me, and it progressed into a really nice steamy evening, which was, after all, we could all use one of those once in a while.
The mind is the best aphrodisiac we have, yet there are really physical components that happen. I see it in my practice. I see men and women who really want to have great sex, but something's wrong physically, chemically, something's just not happening. And definitely when they take the herbs, which react in the body in that chemical process, definitely there's a change, there's an improvement.
When people say, you're taking an aphrodisiac, you know you're taking an aphrodisiac, isn't it all in your mind? Isn't it a placebo? And I look at them and I say, it's very possible that it is. I mean, there's tons of medical records that show people been given placebo medicine and have cured themselves. But hey, who cares as long as it gets you there?
What triggers our passion? Well, that's one of life's great mysteries. As for aphrodisiacs, perhaps the most potent of all are these three time-honored words. I love you. Of course, not all stories end happily. If you have any information about the cases we profiled tonight, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.